not to barf, that you need to just give two barfs. How many of you here can hear the sound of dogs barking? Can you hear your dogs barking? Can you? Well, you know what? I'll tell you how I tell dogs that they need to bark just two times or three times, and then to listen. Because many dogs go bark, 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 bark. And then pretty soon the people can't make them stop. And then they have to get a new home because the people start getting complaints. So if we taught the animals when is it appropriate to bark a lot, then they can keep their home forever and ever. So you guys are so good at picturing things, because that's how I give information. I picture it in my mind, and I see the dog doing it in my mind. You know how you pretend? How many of you pretend that you're Batman? How many of you pretend you're Spider-Man? How many of you pretended that you were Ariel? Yes, and you know when you pretend, you really can feel like you're that person or that animal. When I'm talking to an animal, like if I want a dog to understand that he can't bark a lot, I say, what does it feel like to be you? What does it feel like to be you? And then I close my eyes and I let myself pretend I'm that animal doing the new behavior. If I'm a dog and I've been a big, huge barker, and I need to know, oh, I'm supposed to only do three barks. I want you to pretend you are your dog, and I want you to pretend that you're doing three barks to let your owners know, oh, somebody's coming. And then, three barks, can you hear the three barks? Can? All right, now this is what this is the information they are missing, and that is to listen. Do you know you're listening to me? This is how dogs listen. I want you to get real quiet, and I want you to pretend that you can hear through this wall, through this wall, through that wall, through that wall. And I want you to let yourself go outside the room and hear as much information as you can hear. So let's do that. Close your eyes. Can you hear the breathing? Did you hear the fan?
Yeah.
How many of you heard the car?
Me.
Wow. Do you know that's how dogs can hear? They can hear the information all around. And that's the part they're missing. They're missing the part where we can use our ability to listen, and you just pretend your dog doing it, and they'll go, that's what I'm supposed to do. But then you say, you can't hear a thing if you're barking. You can't. It's like the teacher trying to teach you something, and you're talking. You can't hear what she's saying, right? So when you're with your dogs, you need to tell them quiet and listen so they're not barking a lot, do this. Now what I'm going to do is put a video on, and you're going to be seeing me working with an elephant and two horses. And then I will tell you how I gave the information to them, okay? Do you have the... I can even have to rewind from the other day. And what I want to feel what it was like being Toby, jumping, what I do again is I pretend. Just like you pretend being Spider-Man or Ariel or one of the characters, one of your favorite characters. So, this is what I did. I closed my eyes, and I said, jumping. And all of a sudden I felt, well, who doesn't bring up the legs on the front shoulder? Why don't you all pick up your arms and prepare your front legs? And this is what I felt in my body so that you could understand that all we need to do totally is bring up your front legs. Bring them up, tuck them, and tuck your toes closer to your body, and then jump. And when you jump, straighten out the back just a little bit more. So when you fly over, pull up, tuck, and stretch. That's all I did. I went and pretended I was Toby, jumping over those, tightening up and tucking. And then he got the information. I also told him that this was an important business because the better he did in the show ring, the more money they made, the more pay he got. And when I gave him that vision that when he did really, really well and he'd get piles of pay, he just went, oh. And that way he could understand this was an important thing to do with Mark. Now, how many of you saw that beautiful dark-colored horse down there? Did you watch his legs? Did you watch his legs? Do you know, well, when he was running, how many of you have horses or been on horses? Do you know what barrel racing is? Do you know what barrel racing is? Well, you know, Diamond was a champion barrel racer. And he had all these ribbons and all these trophies. Do you know when you get a star because you've done something really, really good, how it feels? And when you get a piece of paper and you get to take it home and it says, you did very well in school, excellent. How does that make you feel? Really good, doesn't it? Well, what happened is a man saw Diamond doing at a show, and the man went, oh, look at that gorgeous horse. And Diamond was up for sale, and he said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to buy Diamond so as a birthday present for my wife. So he bought Diamond, took Diamond home. Now, his wife wanted a horse that could cross the track. And that's very different ability to move with your legs. It's kind of like, you know how when you're walking, how sometimes you walk, and then sometimes you walk like this. Or sometimes you just skip. It's a different way of walking, different way of movement. Well, Diamond was taught from the tiniest little to do barrel racing. That's a Western form of racing where the legs, the back legs and the front legs move smoothly together very fast and they go around barrel, really close to the barrel, as close to the barrel as they can, as quickly as they can. And that's where he got his award for doing that. Well, foxtrot is where the front legs move different than the back legs. The front legs go like this. Quick, and the back legs go at a slower, smooth, long pace. Front, quick, and the front high and quick, the back slow and smooth. And he didn't know how to do it. And they were trying to teach him how to do it, but he didn't understand. 1 year of training and didn't understand. So what I did you notice that I was just sitting there in the chair? Yes. I said to him, show me what you can do. Because I heard you're a champion and you got trophies. It would be like me saying to you, let me see your trophies. Let me see all the stars you've gotten for being really good at showing up or completing a paper or doing a drawing that is so awesome that everybody wants to look at it and you get acknowledged for it. So what I did is I said, show me what you do. So he took the whole ring and he ran around the barrels, and I could see, oh my gosh, he is so good at moving his legs, at what he does. I told him, you're beautiful at doing that. And then I said, you know what they want me to do? Because your parents, your mom, could do the foxtrot naturally. Your dad could do the foxtrot naturally. Your grandparents could do the foxtrot naturally. All of your lineage of horses could do the foxtrot. That it was a natural way that you could move. And I gave him a picture in my mind by saying, what does it feel like to be you doing the movement? And then I closed my eyes. I moved my front legs fast and high, my back legs long and slow. And then all of a sudden, he started doing it. And the man just stood there and went, oh, I've never seen him do this. Just by pretending and being clear, what do you want them to do? You know, if you were going to run a race, your mom reset, and sometimes you guys were playing, you were running a race, and you, like an athlete, you pretend to win the race, and you feel the ribbon, you go and you run as fast as you can in your mind, what it would feel like to win, what it would feel like to accomplish something, before you've done it, that's what I do. And I talked to a school of a bunch of kids up here in California. And there was a young man in the audience, and he had this little box. And he stood up, and I thought, oh, he's got a little garden snake in there. That's not a problem. I can talk to a garden snake. And he came up on stage, and he opened his box up. And in the box was a little black scorpion with a kind of a red thing that was hanging down from his tail. And I didn't even need to know how to talk to him. Just the shape of his body could tell me, oh, he was not happy. So I told the young man, let's close the lid. And as we closed the lid, I had everybody in the audience send that little scorpion a thought of love, and that you will be going home. And I'm thinking in my mind, I've never talked to a bug. I've never talked to a scorpion before. So this is how I talk to animals, how I can get the information. I get real quiet. It's like I quiet my mind so that I can hear his impressions or his thoughts. I quiet my nervous system. I quiet my emotions. I get real quiet. And then I can listen. And then when I can listen, I get to hear the impression that it may be a feeling that comes in. It may be a little picture, like a movie. Can you guys remember a movie, your favorite part in a movie? What movies do you really like? Tell me, what movie was your favorite movie?
I liked
the T-Rex movie. What's your favorite movie? What was it? Oh, I saw that. Monsters Incorporated. That was a fabulous film. And what part of that film did you like? How many of you saw Monsters Incorporated? What was your favorite part of that movie? And just yell it out. All at once. Yes. Yeah. Somebody else, yell it out. The girl part.
I like the girl.
Yeah.
I like when Boo beats up the lizard guy.
My favorite part
she's back in the bedroom, and that was her friend's dad. They became close friends, and they got to see each other again. That was my favorite part of that film. You like Beauty and the Beast. What part of it is your favorite, and can you see it in your mind right now? Can you recall that? You can? You like Spider-Man. Oh, I love one. So, I'll answer questions in a minute. You can put your hands down and I'm going to finish the story about the scorpion. So, just like we could remember a certain part of your favorite movie, that's what happens. I get this little flash, like looking at a movie, in my mind. So the scorpion sent me a picture that his aquarium was over by a window and that he could look outside. I saw like I was looking out a little glass and I could see trees and it was really, really nice and bright. And where I was wasn't bright. It was dark and I was looking at a wall. There was nothing there. And so I tell the little boy, you know what? You moved his aquarium? And he doesn't like it where it is. Could you possibly move it back? And he said, yeah, I just moved it a couple of days ago. I can move it back. And then I get a picture in my mind of this stuff that looks like hamburger, Roundup brand stuff. And I said to the little boy, he's talking about the Roundup stuff that looks like a hamburger. And that he really liked it, and you haven't been giving it to him for a long, long time. And he said, oh, yes, I can give him more of that. Then the thing I loved most was when he gave me a picture of his red-orange water dish. And how much he loved his red-orange water dish. When I saw that red-orange water dish, I went, oh, he just loves his red-orange water dish. And the little boy went, how did you know he had a red-orange water dish? And I said, your scorpion told me. Even the bugs know about their life. Just by giving me pictures back, when you grow up, this will be much more normal because we're in a new millennium. This is new science. And you're going to meet the scientists, the animal communicators, the veterinarians, the police officers, somebody that's working on the internet to find the new medicine. You'll be the ones because you can still see pictures in your mind, and this won't be foreign. When I was a little girl, nobody talked to the animals that people knew about. It was so strange, nobody even said anything about it. And I was talking to the dogs and the cats, and I thought everybody did, but nobody was talking about it. So, what I'd like you to do is, can you think of some behavior that your dog or your cat's doing that your parents are kind of upset about? Tell me what that is, and we'll tell you how we can help the dog understand what it's supposed to do. Okay, so his dog always barks when his mommy gets on the phone. What do you think, what picture could we give the dog? To say, when the phone rings and mom picks it up, how many of you can see your mom picking up the phone? And here's mom, she just picked up the phone, and the dog is right close by. What picture could we give of that dog to say, you're supposed to listen? Huh? What's the picture we could give?
A picture of the dog.
Yes, a picture of the dog, maybe walking and looking at her, and just laying and listening? With three dogs beside us? I don't know if his mama would like that.
Oh, three, four. You are so bright. You are really listening. You're very good at this.
We'll give the dog a vision of doing three barks, oh, two barks, because that will make mommy feel much better, right? Two barks, and then just, that would be even better. And how could we give him a vision of no barks? What would we see the action the dog would be doing? Open his mouth. Could we just see him walking around? Could we just see him looking at her on the phone and walking around and listening to what's going on outside? Do you think that would be really good? I think that might help. And maybe you could tell your mom, you know, you could give him a treat. Every single time she hangs up the phone and walks away and he hasn't made a sound. What word do you think you could give your dog when your mom's on the phone? Congratulations! Yes! Congratulations for being quiet. Right? Congratulations for listening. You could pet him. You could pet him. What else? You could feed him a treat. What else? Well, it's hard to walk a dog on a leash when you're talking on the phone, but you could give a picture of walking him on a leash after she hung up. You could do that. I'm going to do one more, okay? Well, you have something to say, we'll go to you next. Yes, you could give a picture of her walking the dog afterwards. You have something to say, and then we'll ask a couple back here, and then we'll take another problem, okay? Okay, this is a big problem, and we can help him with this big problem. His kitty jumps on the table and is always wanting to eat food off the table. What picture could you give of the cat? What's the behavior we could give this cat? Yeah, to not get on the table. Well, what if they don't want him on the table? So, could we give a picture of him eating on another place that's high? Because you know what? Do you have a dog in your house? You don't? You have another? You're going to get a dog? Not right now. Have you been talking about getting a dog? But all your dad's going to get a dog. Okay, well, let's say you say to your mom, how about if we put this dish up high on something else, on another table? But you know what? I don't think he feels safe eating it on the floor. So you could compromise with him. You could say, you know what? I know you don't feel really safe eating your dinner on the floor. So I'm going to ask Mom. That may be really good right next to the table or on something else. Yes. Maybe you could get him a box and put it up. So it's just up off the floor. Yeah. Food and his water. And good water. Okay, someone, this one over here. Yes. Real loud. Yes. You can put the kitty up high on the bed. What's another solution? You're fulfilling the need of the animal saying, I'm not safe on the floor, and it would make it a compromise. Make it a compromise. All right, now I'll take one over here. Yes, this one here. Real loud.
When somebody knocks at the door, say bark, and you can't find me in the room.
Now she has two dogs, and when the doorbell rings, somebody comes to the door, they start to bark. So we could do this. Remember the three barks? Then listen and wag your tail. And then give a picture after the people come in, or you shut the door, or they leave, of getting a treat. You guys are really, really, really good at this. Now, I can tell that all of you just love your animals and that your parents take good care of them. You know, well, that is really good, because that's showing that you take responsibility and you care about them. Now, you know, in the Humane Society, a lot of animals aren't cared about. And sometimes people have lots of babies. You know that when I went this year, this was in way back in the beginning, that all these baby kittens were dropped off because there were just too many baby kittens because the mother cats hadn't had somebody to care about them and take them and give them so that they wouldn't have any more babies. So it's real important to love animals, to care for animals, and to give animals pictures, to let them know exactly what we want them to see.
Hi,
Nancy. All right. We'll take a few more questions. Yes. Yes. Real loud. That's what he said is, one time he found a cat in a box at his neighbor's house that nobody wanted. That's what we're talking about, is how do we really help the animals? We help animals by giving them spayed and neutered, so they don't have any more animals. We help animals by loving them, by feeding them, by brushing them, by taking them to the veterinarian, by drawing pictures and saying, I love you, and maybe writing a story. You know, one of the best ways to tell your dog or your cat what you want them to do, and maybe you could do this in your classroom, write a story about your dog or your cat doing exactly what you want them to do. Say they have a problem, and they've been going potty inside the house, and your mom wants them to go outside. Or you know somebody that has a puppy and it's really hard to train a puppy. This is the information that I would give the puppy. You know how a puppy sniffs? First off, you have to take them outside a lot. And second is you have to tell them where to go. So if you give a vision and see a picture of that puppy going outside, and when you're outside, isn't it open? You can feel the sunshine and the trees. You can see the trees and the grass. Yourself and get your question in. And how open it is. Well, if you see the puppy outside where the dirt is or the grass is, and then squatting and going, then that puppy will know, oh, that's where I'm supposed to potty. And then you give a picture, that's true, you need to know that. So then, if you give them a picture like in here, you know how still it is, it has four walls, it has a ceiling, it has a floor, and then I would give pictures of all the things that that puppy could do on the carpet or on the floor inside the house like. Some of the things that the puppy could do would be sleeping. What are some other things the puppy could do? Tell me, what are the things the puppy could do inside on the carpet? Yes. You could play with the puppy. What else? You could run around. Yes. You could drink water in the house. You could roll on the carpet. And then, again, you would what? Show the puppy where to go. Tell me where it would go and describe what's around. How many of you fit? Where would the puppy go to go potty?
Outside.
Outside. And what does it look like and feel like outside? Perfect. The more that you see exactly where it's going to go, it'll do it. So outside feels like what? Real open? Is there sunshine?
Yeah.
Is there trees?
Yeah.
Is there grass outside?
Yeah.
Is there bushes outside?
Yeah.
So that way the puppy would know, oh, inside a house doesn't have grass. Inside a house doesn't have trees. Inside a house doesn't have a bush. Inside a house doesn't have dirt. So that puppy would just go right outside. Now this is very important. When I pretend I'm that puppy, I squat and I pretend I go. And then the puppy goes, that's what I'm supposed to do. And then I pretend that we're walking back inside the house. And what is it supposed to do inside the house on the carpet? What is it? Play. What else? Sleep. What else? Scratch his back and roll. What else? Run. To run around and feel very happy because it knows exactly what the people want it to do. And when you know what you're supposed to do, what does it do? It makes you feel so blessed. Yes! It makes you feel happy. And good. Okay, I think you know exactly what to do. Yes.
Now I have a puppy that is really good about going out the doggy door. But if it's raining or cold outside, she sticks her nose out the door and stays in the house.
What image could we, picture could we give his dog of jumping through when it's raining? Do you think what, could we give him a picture of a place where there's either a tree or close by where it wouldn't get totally wet?
I was thinking maybe drawing a sun and putting it over the door.
You think that might work if he drew a picture of it? Sun and it was really raining outside. You could put it on the ceiling, he said. You could put it on the ceiling. And I think you know what else we could do? He could maybe make an area where it had a cover over a piece of dirt so that it could run out and not get wet like an umbrella. Because sometimes when we go outside, we don't want to get wet. So to help him go outside all the time, maybe you could build a little like a tent over a piece of grass. And then he could give him a vision of jumping out the pet door, running underneath that thing, squat and go, run around in a circle, run through the pet door, and come back into the warm house. I think we could do that. You think we could do that?
Yeah!
Yes. So, I think we got that solved. Well, you guys are really, really lucky. I wish I could answer some more questions, but it's time for us to go. I had a great time telling you what you can do to help an animal. Thank you very, very much.
Well, let's say thank you one more time to Samantha Curry. Let's give her a great big hand. Thank you so much. Okay, boys and girls, please look at you. Stand when you're ready. Have a wonderful rest of the day. The work that she has done with animals. First, talk with us. Give us some information. And she's just a wonderful person, and you are going to enjoy being with her. Let's give a hand to Samantha.
Southern Oregon Humane Society. And they sponsor and take care of animals that other people don't want, or maybe there's cats that have had a lot of babies that are wild and they have no food. So it's a place where people can take their animals if they either have to move or there's a big problem and they can't handle the problem anymore. So what they're doing now is I'm talking about how I communicate with animals. You guys are very visual, and you can see pictures in your mind, and I see pictures in my mind, and I am so good at fantasizing and daydreaming. How many of you are really good at fantasizing and daydreaming? You are? Well, you know, if you can fantasize information, then you can talk to the animals. If you can daydream it, you can daydream them doing something. You can talk to the animals. So, because this is sponsored by them, we're learning how to not only help animals not have more babies, what to do when you care about animals, but we also know that if we can help people know how to talk to animals and tell them what we want, then we wouldn't have a lot of dogs that are just barking, 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 barking. We wouldn't have a lot of dogs that are chewing up furniture. Yeah, we would have our horses know what we're wanting. So today you're going to get to see me work with some elephants at the San Diego Wild Animal Park. One of them is at the San Diego Zoo. And then also two horses. When you watch the horses, I want you to pretend, what would it feel like to be that horse doing that behavior? All right? Okay.
There is an unspoken language between people and their pets, especially if they've been together for a long time. The same intuitive sense that you may have with one pet, some people claim to have with all animals. These aren't just fanciful modern-day Dr. Doolittles. Professional pet interpreters like Samantha Curry get astonishing results.
I'm usually the last hope. The average person comes to see me because they don't know where to turn. This is their last hope.
He's like a translator, is how I would describe it.
People seek out Samantha Curry when the special bond between pet and owner seems to be breaking down. She's part pet psychologist, part sounding board, and claims that her psychic connection with animals is so strong that she can often communicate with a pet even when the owner cannot. It was her work with the elephants at the San Diego Wild Animal Park that first brought Samantha's talents into the national spotlight.
Well, the elephant keeper thought, I guess he figured, why not give it a try?
When I realized that I was in the presence of a very intelligent being, it was overwhelming for me.
Zookeepers were astonished that Samantha knew things about the elephants which were not public knowledge, including the recent death.
You know, Toby was, he was really good at jumping. But you know, when he went into the showroom, he really didn't understand that this was an important business and that he really needed to do the very best he possibly could do. And so when I was watching him, I watched him first just jump, and then I closed my eyes and I let myself pretend I'm Toby. Kind of like, you know how you get to pretend that you're some, let's say, like Spider-Man or Ariel, or give me some names of some people or some characters that you really like to pretend that you are. What's one? Jerry Rice? I don't know who Jerry. Oh, football. I should know what that is. My husband likes the Lakers. Who? Joe Montana. Who? Yes. Steven Seagal? Oh, that's great. Yes?
Goku?
Who's that?
Goku.
Ah, how about some girls? What do you
good.
Who?
Steve McGuire? Oh, Lizzie McGuire. Lizzie, if you could tell, I don't know who that is. Is what? Oh, any others? Yell them out, wow. Yes. Travis? Oh, I've heard her. Him? Well, isn't there a lady named Travis also? That's a singer, Western singer. Because I've heard a female named Travis also. Yes, way back in the back. Yell it really loud.
Mia Hamm.
Mia Hamm. Mia Hamm. Ah, yes. Can't hear it all.
Teletubbies.
Which one? I know what the Teletubbies are. I have a grandchild. So you know that when you're pretending, I'll talk and then I'll take questions and so on. You know when you're pretending to be somebody, how it feels, that you can almost feel what it feels like to be them? Well, that's what I use when I want to find out about a horse or an elephant, what it feels like to be them. So I use that term. What does it feel like to be you? And then I pretend that I am them, doing the behavior. And then I can feel it in my body, and then I get little flashes in my mind. So with Toby, what I did was I could feel that when he made the jumps, he was just, his front legs were a little bit too loose. He wasn't really concentrating, and he didn't realize how important this was. So if you take, now I use my body and my mind and my emotions to give information and to get information. Because I think that all of me is like a big, huge brain, kind of like a computer, where it has all the components, you can put all the components in, and it'll come out so that you understand it. So you could do like a little search, have a little search engine and get all the information. So this is what happens. I let myself get quiet, close my eyes, I'm Toby doing the jumps. And then I felt my body as if, take your shoulders and just tuck them closer to you, and then pull them up tight. Get the feeling in your body. Feel your shoulders coming up, and as if you just took your hands and they were hooks and bring them closer. That's the sensation. That is the sensation that I transmitted to him. This is what you need to do, and this is all you need to do. Just lift your front legs up, tuck them closer to your body, and then when you jump, stretch that back leg out. That was all I did. And he got it. And then he turned around and he started going over the jumps the way he's supposed to. Now I did one other thing, because he didn't understand that this was a business, that him and Mark had a business, they were business partners. And that the better job that he did in the show ring, the more people would come to them to get trained. The more people that come, the more money you make. And how I gave the horse information about this was that I gave him pictures of having more hay. That the better job he did, the more hay he'd get. And it worked. He understood then, oh, the better job, I get a bigger treat. Kind of like if you knew you could do a really good job and did a really good job in school, and you were going to be doing some special project, and when you got home, you would not only get acknowledged, but you'd get to do something special, like go someplace. Then you would try really hard. Now Diamond was a little different. Did you notice how pretty he is? How gorgeous the body is, and the way his legs were moving? How many of you have horses? You have horses? How many of you know what barrel racing is? Okay, he was a champion barrel racer.
and he had been trained from the time he was little up to barrel race to do Western style riding. And he was so good at it that he was a champion horse and he had many trophies and ribbons. You know how it feels when you get a paper that says you've done an excellent job and you get to take it home and your parents take a good look at it and they really acknowledge you for what you've done? You know how that feels? It feels really good, doesn't it? Well, what happened is Diamond was up for sale and he's at a show and he's doing all the barrel racing, doing such a good job. The man saw him and said, "Oh my gosh, look at this unbelievably beautiful horse and his ability to move." He decides he's going to buy him. And he bought him for a lot of money. And he was going to be a gift for his wife for her birthday. It was a surprise. Now his wife wanted a horse that could foxtrot. And Diamond's parents were foxtrotters. His whole long line lineage was foxtrotters. So that was something natural for him to do. But he didn't know how to do it because when he was a baby, he was taught only one thing, barrel racing. And how in the world do you know how to foxtrot if you're a barrel racer? And if people aren't showing you exactly what to do, it's confusing. Right? So, they tried for one whole year to train him and he didn't get it. And he didn't get it. Then he finally heard about me and the man and said, "Well, this is really pretty far out, but we're going to try it anyway." So what I did, because I knew that Diamond was a champion horse and that he had lots of ribbons, I wanted to see what he could do first. And so I asked him, "Show me what you're good at. Show me." So he took that whole huge arena, which is about 2 times longer than this place, and wider. He went all the way to the end, and then started going around the barrels and did the figure eight, and just showed me how absolutely gorgeous. And I started to cry because he was so magnificent and nobody was acknowledging him that he was a champion in this anymore. And then after I acknowledged him and I closed my eyes and I gave him pictures in my head of what he needed to do. Now foxtrot means that the front legs move at a faster speed than the back legs. It's a quick movement, and he has a tendency to bring his legs up really high anyway. So I gave him pictures of lifting the front legs like this. I don't want to fall. Like this, real high. The back legs go smooth and long, quick, quick. So that's all I did. I pretended that I was him, moving at this fast speed, quick, quick in the front, long stride in the back. How many of you could feel that in your body? How many of you can actually pretend that you're him and that you could move your body that quick? The more that you can see it in your mind and pretend you are that horse or that dog or that elephant doing the behavior, the quicker the animal gets it. Now there's a big gift in here for us humans. When you fantasize what you want and you hold that vision, you can make it happen. Do you know that many Olympic athletes, their trainers have them pretend that they are running the race in their mind at night? And they say, "Feel yourself hit that ribbon. Feel as if you're coming in first, what it feels like if you finished the race before anybody else." So that you can apply this ability to fantasize, to daydream what you want in your life, the more you fantasize, the the more clear pictures you can send. Let me hear what kind of things that you have at home, dogs and cats and problems. Let's start right here. Yeah. You don't have a problem? I want a problem. Yes. Okay, first up, you have wild cats under the house. You know, you can call the Humane Society, and they have a program where they can come out and catch them, and then fix them, and then release them. So you should call, have your mom call and get in touch with that program. And then they won't be having more babies. That's a big problem here in Southern Oregon, I know. Yes. She has a kitty, and they had two kitties, and one kitty died, and the other one's sad. So one of the things that you can do is, you know how you can feel how sad that kitty is. Well, if you think about taking, this is a pretend, this is a wonderful pretend. You can pretend that you're taking the heart and the emotional love that you have and surround that kitty, your kitty, and maybe pet it a little bit more, and tell it in your mind that we just love you and we know that you miss your friend. Okay? That will help a lot. Because when you take your emotions, your love, you can lift anything. You can lift anything. Yes. Yes. Every time he goes, you go up to feed him, he scratches and bites. Every single time. What do you think is the reason? You think he's scared of you maybe a little bit? Of being grabbed? I think maybe that the scratching and the biting is saying, stay at a distance, don't come too close to me. I think that might be what he's saying. I think it might be. What I give him is a picture that you're going to go over, put the food and the water in, and then you'll walk away. That you won't even touch him and see what happens. Give him a picture that you're walking over to the food dish, you put the food in, you put the water in, you won't even touch him or grab him, and you'll turn and walk away and see what happens. This one here, and then I want to talk about a couple of stories. You have a rooster that always attacks you. Okay, today when you go home, what, is he in a pen and you have to put your feet down or just run around? He's in a pen. Okay, this is what I do. Give him the fantasy, fantasize that you're going to go in there ahead of time. And then you're gonna put the water just like I gave her.
You're going to put the water down, you're going to put the food down. See it walking back and forth, just watching you. And then you walk out, and then it hasn't touched you. I love evidence. I think evidence of what you're doing in your mind is so important. So the more you fantasize what that animal or that bird's going to do, what you're going to do, and then you're going to walk out, and that animal didn't get hurt, you didn't get hurt. Okay? You'll get the evidence of your visions. I told you earlier. Yes. right here. I'll get you again a little bit later so everybody gets a chance, okay? Yes. But be real loud because I have problems here. Your cat always comes.
Can you say it?
Your cat always comes home. Oh, the cat always comes scratched up? Comes home scratched up, fighting? Oh, on his ear. So he's been fighting with somebody. Has it been really spayed? And it has, and it's still going out and getting beat up? I would tell it to stay home. I would give it a vision of staying home and safer. You know, now I'm going to tell you a cute story about when I was doing a lecture at another school, and this little boy stood up, and I'll get to you guys in a minute.
Put your hands down.
And I saw one of the kids in the audience, and he stood up, and he had a little box, and he came up on stage, and inside that little box, I'm thinking, oh, it's a little garden snake. I can talk to a garden snake. I'm having problems with garden snakes. So he came up on stage, and he opens this box up. Inside the box was this scorpion. Does anybody know what a black scorpion looks like? You catch it? Do you know that was the first time I had ever seen a black scorpion? And do you know that they got that little red heart thing that hangs down from their tail? That, I know it's poisonous. And I said, when I saw him curled up, I went, oh my goodness. I said to the little boy, I think we better just shut the lid. So we shut the lid, and I said to the whole audience, let's send him a thought that he's going to be safe, and that he's going to go home, and let's just send a thought of love. And so everybody did that, so he wouldn't feel scared in that box. And I'm thinking to myself, I never had talked to a bug before. I'm not even sure if this is possible. And I'm up in front of all these people. And I thought, okay, just quiet yourself for a minute, Sam. So when I want to find out information, I take a deep breath. And I quiet my mind. Actually, what I do is I think, how do I make myself so peaceful so quickly? You know, if you watched, how many of you watched a sunset, the sun go down? Do you know how that makes you feel just quiet? I pretend I'm looking at a sunset. And that sunset's going down, and it just makes my mind quiet. It makes my emotions quiet. It makes my nervous system quiet. And when my mind isn't thinking, chattering thoughts, I can receive information. When my emotions aren't going like this, where I'm feeling happy one minute, sad next minute, and going all over the place, then I can feel what that animal or that bug or whatever it is, I can feel what its feelings are. Then if the nervous system isn't going like this, nervous system is almost like, you know how some people drink a lot of coffee? Well, their body starts going like this inside. And most animals, when they look at people, especially adults, they'll go over, especially dogs. Dogs will go over and go, oh my goodness, that person needs some help. I'm going to rub on that person. They'll go over and rub on their leg. And they're not talking to them. They're just going, you need help.
I'm going to rub on your leg, and then they'll go outside and then roll on the earth. Yes, that's what they do. But when I want them to talk to me, I have to be really quiet inside so I can hear them. So that I can hear them. And you know how I get the information? I'll get a little flash, like a little picture, like a quick little memory from a movie. You know, if you think about some movie that you really and truly love, you can recall that part of the movie you like and all the dialogue. You can almost hear them talking. Well, that's how I get a little picture, like a little flash in my mind. I get a little bit of feelings. I sometimes get a funny impression. I might even get, oh, let's say, I know, one day I was called to work with this horse to learn how to trailer him. And then the horse's name was Sunny. And they had a horse before. And when they tried to trailer Sunny, what happened is, or when they tried to trailer the other horse, what happened was it was coming out of the trailer and he broke his leg. And they were so scared that Sunny wouldn't know how to get trailered properly. So they asked me, could you give him a picture in your mind of how to get into a trailer and how to get out of a trailer? I said, oh, yeah, I could do that. So I go over to see Sunny and the trailer's not there. I sat down and I closed my eyes and I asked Sunny, do you know about trailer? And I gave him a picture. Everybody knows what a trailer looks like for horses, right? All I did was recall what that looks like in my mind. And Sunny tells me, oh yeah, I know about my trailer. They took the fenders off. They painted the bottom half yellow. And I went, oh, this is the first time I've ever gotten color from an animal. I didn't think animals saw color. And I just write down the information. Now, how did I know that he was talking about his trailer? He gives me a picture back in my mind of the trailer and then taking these things off. And when I saw that these things by the wheel, I know they're fenders, kind of like the computer again. So he gives me vision that they took those off and then I saw the bottom half, this yellow color. So I write it down, then he tells me he knows what the trailer is, he's not frightened, that he knows to how to get in and get out. And I give him visions as if I am him, getting in and getting out. I write it down, he's not worried, he knows how to back up, he knows how to go forward on it. And then all of a sudden, I get this picture of this duck on his back, and I'm thinking, oh, this must be my imagination. Where did this come from? And I have learned, don't add anything more to the communication that came in. Don't take anything away, and be willing to risk being wrong to get clear information. So I write it down, duck. So then I tell the lady that her horse, Sunny, knows all about the trailer. And then I have a choice. I have a choice to tell her about the duck, because I'm not sure that Sunny gave me this information. And I worded it this way. This sounds so strange, but Sunny starts talking about this duck. And she said, oh yes, Sunny grew up in our backyard with this duck and a swimming pool, and it had grass. We had a little stall in the backyard for Sunny. I have learned that anytime I'm talking to another species, that I get the impressions, whatever the impression is, I write the impression down, I don't add anything more to it, I don't take anything away. So now I let myself get very quiet, and I turn and I look at that box of where the scorpion is. And I know whatever comes in, I'm going to trust it. I'm going to trust it. So all of a sudden, I get this vision of my aquarium, terrarium, being moved from being able to look out the window to a place by a wall that's a little darker, and I don't like it. I like looking out the window. So I say to the young man, you know, he talks about being moved from a place where he could look out the window to this place that's not got a lot of light, and it's kind of dark, and he really likes it over by the window. So he said, yeah, a couple of days ago I moved that. I said, I think it would be wise if you moved it back, he'd be happier. And then he gave me a picture of this stuff that looked like, I'll get you guys in a few minutes, okay, looked like hamburger. And I said to him, he gives me this feeling like, you know how you long for some kind of candy that you really, really love? The feeling of, oh, I really desire that, but you haven't had a long time. It's a feeling. He gives me that feeling. And what I do is I write down the feeling, oh, I'd love to have this hamburger again. It's been a long time since I've had this hamburger. So I give him a picture back to, I told the young man, well, you know what? He really liked that stuff. Could you give it to him again? He said he would. And the thing I loved most was then he gave me a picture of his red, orange water dish. I love it when they give me something so clear and visual. And the young man's eyes got really big and he said, how did you get that? And I said, your little scorpion knows about its environment. Doesn't that amaze you that this little bug knows visually, because they see things all visually, all animals do, because they can't learn how to read, and they're not supposed to do that. So the young man said he would move him back, and he was just so happy to understand this little creature. What's really fabulous is all of you are already still have that ability to fantasize and daydream. It is a very powerful tool. Not only does athletes use it, but people that want to be able to achieve something that seems very, very, very hard. You hold a dream of what you'd like to do or what you'd like to get, and you hold that in your mind that someday you'll be able to do that and you could do it. Fantasize yourself achieving it. Fantasize what you want. Fantasize what you want your dogs, your horses, your cats to do. Because that's the missing part. The missing part is them doing the behavior as if they've already done it. We see them doing the bad behavior. And so then when they do it, they get mixed messages. Now, I said I was going to come back to two people. There was, yes, this one, and Roman. And then it goes back to you. So this young man first, all right? Say it real loud. On the problem? Yes, you can. Well, I give it to the veterinarian because there's some medicine that you can give them for mites. And then the vet can check them out on why they're not eating because they just may not be feeling really good. So you have to clean everything out really good and get the medicine from the veterinarian, okay? Because that will help a whole lot. They may have to feel better for a little bit before they eat. Okay, and see them eating. Be your snake eating that. I know that sounds really gross, but I bet it is. My kids used to have snakes. I couldn't watch it, though. I couldn't watch it. Okay, back here. Real loud.
I've seen this one show where there's these two dogs, and there's Elmer, and they're
gone back to get help. How many of you could hear the people talking over there? How many of you could hear the fans?